I love your sax. Good evening, and a very happy Sabbath to you. I'm Dick Dirksen, and I work for Maranatha Volunteers International, and tonight, your Vespers is our Vespers, an opportunity to talk about Jesus is coming soon. Maranatha, happy Sabbath. Many places in the world where we go, they're saying Maranatha long before we can get it out, looking forward to the coming of Christ. Tonight, we want to talk with you a little bit about Maranatha and about some of the crazy things we're doing in the world, and we've got a couple of your fellow students to do some sharing of their experiences. So I hope you have a good time. Sabbath reading, you ready? Let's see, there it is. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do, you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your manservant, nor your maidservant, nor your cattle, nor the stranger within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. It's really a challenge when we have so many different versions. I've been recently memorizing that from the Message, and so I'm starting to listen here, and it really doesn't matter, does it? At the end of 6 days, God said, come, sit down with me. The next few hours are mine with you.
There are 17 million Seventh-day Adventists around the world. They make up 139,000 congregations. But not all of them have an adequate place to worship. They're meeting under trees, in homes, or under tarps. They need a church. There are 7,883 Seventh-day Adventist schools, but many are too small or falling apart. Sometimes there's no school in town, and children have to walk for miles. They need a school. Maranatha Volunteers International. We recruit volunteers to build churches, schools, wells, urgently needed structures that transform lives and bring hope to a community. For 45 years, we've worked in more than 80 countries with 60,000 volunteers. Together, we're changing the world, one block, one building, one person at a time. All for the glory of Jesus Christ. Maranatha.
Good evening, and welcome to University Vespers. On behalf of Maranatha, I'd just like to thank you so much for inviting us to be here this evening. My name is Christina Lloyd, and I'm the producer of Maranatha Mission Stories, Maranatha's television program. Does anybody here a Maranatha Mission Stories watcher? Awesome, lots of hands, awesome. I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what Maranatha does and how what Maranatha does has impacted my life personally. Maranatha's mission statement is that we spread the gospel throughout the world while building people through the construction of urgently needed buildings. Now, there's two components to that. There's the building people, and then there's the building buildings, and they're equally important. I graduated from Andrews in 2004, in May of 2004, and in January of 2005, I found myself in India working for Maranatha Volunteers International. I had never really been involved in missions before. It was a very, very new experience for me, and it was really culture shock for me. In India, we have been in India for over 15 years, and with a population of 1.2 billion and a lot of them being Hindu and Muslim, you can understand that India is a huge mission field. And Maranatha really has had their work cut out for them in that country. When we were visiting areas that were requesting churches, we were in an area that had specifically requested a school that Maranatha was going to build them. And with the film crew, we were going around visiting churches and seeing the children that were going to be impacted by the school that we were going to build. And one Sabbath morning, the pastor had been taking us to what seemed like 100 churches, and it was always, let's go see one more church. Just one more church. And it was just a marathon of church visits. And when we arrived at the final church, we saw a group of people that were meeting not in a church, but under a tree. And we met with them, and we tried to get their story. And what we found out was they had a church. Well, it sort of was a church, but the Thursday prior, their church had been hit by a windstorm and had essentially been blown away. And instead of postponing church worship or canceling the service, they decided that they were going to still worship, but they were going to worship under the tree. And it was really profound to see this group that was so committed to worshiping God that it didn't matter that their church was gone. They were still going to gather and worship and worship God. Well, we decided to get a group photo of the people in front of the church. And so we took a photo and we asked them, hey, could you sing a hymn for us? And these are the words, this is the tune that came out of their mouth. And these are the words to the hymn that they sang. Jesus is my Savior, I should not be moved. In his love and favor, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved. And for me, that was a really profound statement that these people, it didn't matter whether they had a church or where they were worshiping under a tree, they were going to worship God. And we went back to our office and we were like, we have to build these people a church. We can't just let them, you know, stay under this tree. And sure enough, we were able to provide this congregation with a church. And a few years later, we were able to visit them and see their brand new church. They're grateful, they're growing, and they are still there, standing strong in their community and praising God. But the impact that Maranatha makes is not just on the recipients of the buildings that we build. It's the people that go and build as well. Every year, Maranatha does a project for 14 to 18-year-olds called The Ultimate Workout. And I have to be really honest, I don't like this project. It is my least favorite project. I don't gel with teenagers. So I went on one, and then I found excuses not to go. I would conveniently plan my vacation during the project. Or I would find somebody else that just had to go, and I had to stay in the office. But this past summer, my number was up. I had to go on the Ultimate Workout. And the first couple days were really tough. It was hard for me to connect with the kids, and it was hard to get deep and to build relationships with them. But it was through this experience that I really met some teenagers that were really committed to making an impact in their community. Now, the goal of this particular project was to build a large school in Ecuador, to conduct medical clinics, to do children's programs, and just to do anything that they could to make this community in Ecuador a better place. And some of those opportunities really just landed in their laps. One day during the medical clinics, a little girl named Rosia came to the clinic with her little sister. Their parents, we didn't know where they were. They just showed up at the clinic wanting to be seen by the doctors and nurses. And while they were waiting in line, a few of the teenagers walked by and noticed that Rosia really didn't have adequate footwear. Her toes were peeking out of her shoes. Her socks had holes in them. And the kids were like, you would never see that at home. We have to do something about this. So immediately, people started pulling money out of their pockets, out of their purses, out of their wallets, and we were on the way to the shoe store to get Rosia new shoes. On our way back, we came, took her old shoes off, washed her feet. It was like an ultimate foot washing, washing this little girl's dirty feet and putting brand new shoes and socks on her feet. And there was not a dry eye in the room. But it really showed me that these teenagers were having their hearts tuned to seeing exactly what a need was and saying, I cannot pass this by. I have to do something about that. And tonight, you have the privilege of meeting some of those teenagers that were on the project. And I'd like to introduce you to Saikar, and she will tell you a little bit about her experience.
Good evening. I will be talking about my spiritual and how I grew spiritually and how's my relationship with God. About 3 years ago, I was probably at my lowest point of my life. I had some doubts and I was rebellious. I had so many questions about my family, about myself, even our church, and even at the Bible. Growing up, my mom left us and she went here when I was 8 years old, and she divorced my abusive father after that. And 5 years, and then after a few years later, we came here to America. And then we lived with my stepfather, and since then. My Catholic mother found her new faith in God in the SDA church through my stepfather, and we all followed the same path. Soon after, however, the world and the mystery of teenage years got into me, and I began to wander around and did things that I'm not supposed to do. Don't get me wrong, I knew what was right, but I still went the other way around. I attended church and participated in services. I was even a member of a gospel ministry singing, and we went all over the states and other churches. I felt lost and had no sense of direction of where my life was going. I was bitter about everything and was just going through the motion each and every day, trying to survive, trying to find peace and joy in my life. I thought of visiting my home country, the Philippines, to pursue my college education, be closer to my biological dad, and perhaps become closer to God and find meaning in my life. But God had a better plan for me. I had an opportunity to go to 3ABN, where Pastor John Lumakang is the pastor there, and we were talking about my life experience and how is my spiritual experience right in that time. And he told me about Ultimate Workout. With the full support of my parents, I eventually took part in the Ultimate Workout and traveled to Nicaragua. I didn't know exactly how my life was going to change as a result of my participation. I did know, however, that I was determined to experience God, however challenging it is. First of all, traveling with new people I didn't know gave me the chance to make new friends. We had fun together and learned from each other. We worked harmoniously as a team. The morning and the evening worships were very uplifting. We were a family away from home. Secondly, being in a country I've never been before was an experience of a lifetime. The places we went to visit was just beautiful. The culture was very interesting and it was very enlightening. The people we meet and served was grateful and content with what little they had, even though, you know, we would give out toys and they were already happy. Just even our presence there, talking about Jesus and singing in front of them, they were already happy. My world expanded and it led me to appreciate more of what God had blessed me in America. The Ultimate Workout have given me the direction and foundation which I desperately needed in my life to grow in Christ. It diverted me from my personal problems to helping others solve theirs. From selfishness to sharing for the needs of others. It gave me a relief from the harmful abundance of American lifestyle. I am currently studying to become a nurse, and I intend to dedicate my profession in serving others and sharing God's love to anyone. Ultimate Workout changed my life, and by God's grace, I want to be the change that this world so desperately needs, especially to the youth. In Matthew 25, verses 34 to 40, it says, "Then the king will say to those on his right hand, Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. I went with spiritual emptiness and dissatisfaction, but came home abundantly blessed with a brighter tomorrow in sight. Above all things, I came face to face to a seemingly distant God and developed a sense of belonging and purpose. Thank you, and God bless you.
I feel as if there is nothing more helpful for their soul than to go out and help others. That's why we are set on this earth. That is what we yearn for, and that is what we're made to do. So what better thing to do than to set out and actually do something for the world?
I guess coming here, it was a really back road, and there were several like full-on streams that we had to drive through. And so like I was sitting in the car, my window was rolled down, and like the water was like almost gonna start coming in the window.
One of my favorite parts of this trip is definitely being up here in the mountains, and just the view from up here, the quiet, it's just amazing.
Watching people slip while we were walking up to our job site.
You're never clean, like even if you shower, you're never clean. Like, I just slipped in the mud right now. It's always muddy. You're never clean, ever.
The best moment was playing with the children. To see those kids, the smiles on their faces, and just to see them just lit up because we're playing volleyball or soccer with them, it's just a great experience. Because they've been telling me that, you know, they haven't had people come and play with them like this in forever.
In the community, today we were just painting a part of the town to make it look a little presentable, a little prettier than it was. And there was an older lady, I would consider her my grandma. She came by and in Spanish conveyed to us how grateful she was. And I don't know the heavenly language of Spanish, but what I did grasp was just her thanks.
I've never actually been on a mission trip. This is my first mission trip. And I just want to get a feel of what it's like. I didn't have any big expectations. And doing this kind of work has really shown me what my passion is and has really confirmed the fact that I really want to become a doctor and serve abroad.
One thing I've learned about myself on this mission trip, and one thing that I was really praying that God would kind of show me while I was here, was whether I should do missions long term. I had felt pretty strongly that that's what I wanted to do after my year as a student missionary, and being back in the mission field and spending time here has really confirmed that I believe that's what God's calling me to do.
Good night, everyone. My testimony is more of a Jonah story, because I feel like I've been running from God for so long to the point that I'm getting tired of it, and it's like I need a water break. And I feel like Maranatha, that was my water break. It's to the point that God saved me and preserved me through so many things. It's like I have so much IOUs to write out to God that I can't say no if he asks me to do something. Like, I should be dead right now. I should be in jail right now, I should be a father, but God preserved me from all that. And I can't understand why, because I feel so ungrateful and I feel so unworthy to do certain things. The fact that I'm standing here, a kid like me, I come from a neighborhood where I'm surrounded by negativity. My friend just died a couple weeks ago. My homeboys, they're getting locked up left and right. My brother, that's crazy. But it's just so much negativity, it's drugs, everything is around me. And I grew up in a church, but church becomes so much of a cliche after a while. When you grew up there so long, and it's more of a routine than more of your spirituality. And my mom started to see that, and she was in Trinidad at the time. I remember she used to always watch 3ABN, and she always used to watch Kids Time. I just hated that. But she used to see the mission stories, and she told me one day she wants to see me on one of those mission trips. And I laughed. I'm like, nah, not me. So she called me one day while she was in Trinidad, and she said, I'm going to sign you up for something called Ultimate Workout. And I played sports, so I'm like, I could work out at home. I don't understand what's this workout. And so she was explaining to me, and I just brushed it off. I just, okay, whatever, yeah. I couldn't see myself doing that. Me, and when I try to talk to my friends about it, they're like, nah, that's not you, this and that and that. So eventually, it came to the point where I was actually going, and she was serious, and she bought the plane ticket and all that. And I'm like, well, are you going? Because I'm not. But then it's crazy because I tried so hard to miss the flight. I woke up late, brushed my teeth, flight 5 minutes, all that. And I actually did get to the airport late, and I missed the time to check in. So I'm crossing my fingers. I'm like, yes, I'm not going. But eventually, I don't know what happened. I started walking around. My dad started talking to people, and I eventually got on the flight. And I don't know. I thank God for allowing me to get on this flight, because it opened so much opportunities for me. And on that flight, the first trip to Nicaragua, I vowed to myself to be the black sheep. I'm like, I don't want to be here. I already feel like an outcast. And I just felt like I'm going to try to set myself away. I'm not going to be friendly to anybody. I'm not going to talk to anybody. I'm just going to be here. And I try to have that image, but that night when I got there, I couldn't sleep. And it's like, God, he kept messing with me. And I'm like, God, I'm already here. What do you want me to do? And I've heard a voice. He was like, Esau, just change. I'm saving you through too many things. I need you. And that night, I woke up. Well, the next morning, I woke up and I felt different. I actually, like, it didn't feel weird to be friendly. And I felt like I needed to be there. It was something for me. So I end up loving it. I enjoyed it. I actually received a scholarship to come to the next trip, which was Ecuador that just passed. And I feel like there's so much opportunities that God's brought me through. And to see other kids, like how they live in different countries, and you think you have so much, and you take a lot of things for granted until you actually see how other people live. And it kind of opens your mind. Like, I used to always see the commercials on TV about the pot-belly kids in Africa. And I just, like, flipped through the channel, like, I don't want to see that. I took it for granted. But when you're actually there and you actually witness and you're actually a part of something, it makes you feel a kind of way to know that despite all the bad things I've done in my life, God could still use you. And the kids, they don't even know you. The communities you help, these people don't know you. But you're an answer to their prayers. And I wrestle with that. Ecuador, the same thing. I just felt more enthusiastic to go. In Ecuador, I actually got to the airport early, like 2 hours early this time. And it just felt so good to be there. And I feel like God is continuing to use me. I'm not perfect. I'm not one to sugarcoat anything. I've done a lot of things in my life, but I feel like the bad stuff, if you work for God, who can be against you? If God wants you, I feel just like Jonah. If you can run all you want, but if he has a calling on your life, you're not going anywhere. And I've learned, I'm just going to take it easy. I'm just going to let God do his thing. because I don't want to get swallowed by a whale. I mean, so I actually have a little poem that I made, and it says, "The fact that I'm here is nothing more but a miracle. I have a short story to share, so I might as well make it lyrical. It all started 1.5, maybe 2 years ago. When my mother told me I was going on UW, I thought it to be rather hysterical. Me, on a mission trip? I couldn't see it. If I told you I was reluctant to go, would you believe it? After all, I'm standing here in the flesh. How could this be? I went from not wanting to take part to being here today, chosen to speak. You see, my God is unique. He works in mysterious ways. I was drowning in the ocean of sin, tossed and turned in the waves. Then he reached out his arms and told me, Esan, be saved. I have a special work for you to do before you rest in peace in your grave. And on the first trip to Nicaragua, I vowed to myself to misbehave, conjuring up a plan I plotted there on the plane. But as I reached there that night, God tampered with my brain because I woke up the next morning feeling different. My heart changed, and it didn't feel strange to be friendly. The fact that I was putting other people before myself was music to my soul, a sweet melody. Building those one-day churches, helping people in need, all the bad things I've done in my life, it felt cool to do some good deeds. Because where I'm from, I'm surrounded by drug dealers, killers, and thieves. These 2-week trips offered me such a sense of relief. And on the last night there, when scholarships were received, my name was called to come to Ecuador. You can imagine how glad this made me be. My mind, body, and soul was entirely filled with glee, not knowing, more or less understanding the plans that the master had in store for me. I thank the Lord for my parents who constantly prayed for me, and I thank Maranatha for giving me this grand opportunity to share a chapter in my life that changed the outcome of my story. I should have been dead or incarcerated, but to God be the glory. And to all the communities that we've helped, our names and faces may have disappeared, but that's okay, because it's such a grand feeling to know we were the answer to their prayers. Amen. Amen.
There was always an AK-47 leaning against the thatch of his hut. And Felipe was 6. But he knew right where that gun was, and he knew how to use it. Because in his country of Mozambique, the Portuguese had just left, and now Frelimo and Renamo had decided that they were going to take over the country, and they were in a big, huge civil war. Frelimo kind of supported the government. Renamo supported the people. And Felipe's folks were Renamo. Clear in the northern corner of Mozambique in Nampula province, the houses are simply straw huts, rondavels, round, about 12 feet across, with palm thatch for the top and an upside-down earthen pot right over the hole. Keep the rain out and let this smoke get away. Felipe was raised to be sure Renamo won. At age 6, he was given the hardest job in town, he thought. Take care of the family goats and sheep. There weren't very many, but several of the other families in town had contracted with his parents, who were both soldiers in Renamo. So they had their own AK-47s, but they always made sure that Felipe had access because he might have to fight. And every day, he would look at that rifle leaning against the straw. He would take the sheep and the goats. He didn't take the rifle, but he took one big, really honking, excellent catapult, he called it. And then he'd take the sheep and the goats, a couple score, and he'd go out and take care of them. One night, he was lying on his mat, and mat is not a fair word. It's really nothing more than a towel, piece of fabric on the ground next to the rifle. And he was lying there in the middle of the night. All of a sudden, he had a dream. In the dream, he saw a picture. The photograph, it was just like a photograph, except there were sounds that came along with it. There was a man who came flying into the sky, and he had a bright golden crown. And he had a white jacket and bright, bright eyes. And all around him, there were angels or something flying. And on the earth, he could see people. Some of them were really happy to see the guy, and others were jumping off of cliffs because he was there. And then the dream was gone. Well, he didn't know at all what to do with it. So he woke his parents, and he said, "Mama, Papa, this is the story." And he told the entire dream. And at the end of the dream, Mother said, "Felipe, that is the kind of thing the Catholic Portuguese used to talk about. That it has nothing to do with anything true. You need to throw it away, get it out of your mind, because what we want you to remember is we are the people of Mozambique, and we are in charge. You don't need to worry about any man in the sky. Now, go back to bed. Take care of the sheep in the morning." And he did. For a week, for a month, for a year and a half. And then one day, he's been to a little bit of school. He goes to town. And there was a magazine seller. You know, and they don't have big stores to sell magazines. They simply have a man on the corner who has put out a few pieces of cardboard. And on the cardboard, he's got a couple of magazines. And in this case, he had about a dozen magazines. And one of them was underneath the others. And it had a bright red top on it. And so Felipe looked at it, and he just saw the covers of all the others, and he comes to that one. He said, "I wonder what that is." And he pulled down the magazine that was on top, looked at the second magazine, and gasped. The picture on the cover of that magazine was exactly the picture from his dream. Now, his dream at this point had been 3 years earlier. He bought the magazine, found a few pennies, bought the magazine, went around the corner, hid because he knew what his parents had said. "Have nothing to do with this." And he read the magazine from cover to cover, trying to work out every single word. The title on the magazine in Portuguese was Signs of the Times. It was printed by the Portuguese publishing house in Brazil for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Felipe had never heard of the Seventh-day Adventists. He'd never heard of anybody, the signs of the times. He had no idea what any of this was about, but he read it, and then he read it again, and then he read it again, and then he read it again until he knew, had memorized that entire magazine. And at that point, he made two decisions. "I must find a Seventh-day Adventist because I have no idea what they are, but they must be nice people if they knew my dream. And I must go to school. I want to tell other people about my dream." Told his parents what he wanted to do, and they threw him out, minus the rifle. Said, "You're on your own." And so 9-year-old Felipe traveled until he found someone who knew what a Seventh-day Adventist was. And that person happened to know where a Seventh-day Adventist primary school was. And Felipe went to that town, enrolled in the school, slept under trees and under cardboard, anything he could, to be able to go to school through primary, through secondary. All the time asking people, "Tell me more. I want to know about my dream. I want to know about this person coming out of the sky. I need to learn. I need to understand. Please help me." It was just again and again and again. Well, in the process of this, Felipe decided God had called him with that dream to be a Seventh-day Adventist minister. I sat with him one day in Mozambique. One of those days when we were building churches in near the capital of Maputo. Felipe was at that point 27 years old, responsible for 27 churches. And I said, "Felipe, tell me that story again." He did. And I said, "Do you still have that magazine?" He said, "I do." And from his omnipresent little tiny case, he pulled a plastic enclosure and pulled the magazine out and handed it to me. Señal de los tiempos. Signs of the times. And it's a picture of Jesus' second coming. So I spent some time, and I got the years and figured this out. Felipe's dream came almost a year and a half before the editor of the Brazilian Signs of the Times asked a Brazilian artist to paint the second coming. The Brazilian artist prayed that God would lead him correctly, painted the second coming using exactly the dream God had given Felipe. And then they published it almost 3 years after Felipe's dream, and somehow an angel, who else would take care of this? And when I get to heaven, the first thing I'm going to do is go to the angels from supply. I want to understand how all this works. An angel took that thing all the way from Brazil, from Sao Paulo, and takes it all the way to Mozambique, takes it up into Nampula province, takes it to the little tiny village where an AK-47 leans against the straw of a little boy's hut and makes sure it gets buried and uncovered so that a little boy will choose to become a Seventh-day Adventist pastor. And I said, Felipe, was it just the picture? Oh, no, 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 because I didn't know anything. And when I finally found a little primary school, there was a Seventh-day Adventist teacher. He loved me. He taught me about Jesus. That was God, too. And then when I got to high school, and then when I went to Solusi Adventist University in Zimbabwe and trained to be a pastor, and then when I came back, and if you go to Mozambique today, you'll find Felipe. He's at the union office, unfortunately. But he's in charge of all the Seventh-day Adventist pastors. He's the ministerial director for the Mozambique Union. Is that cool or what? And God is busy giving crazy nightmares to little boys. And I kept asking Felipe, have your parents? And he said, no, 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 no. I keep going. I love my parents. And they have finally said it's okay and they're proud of me. That's all. That's all. They're proud of me, but they don't want to be Christians. But Pastor Dick, one of these days, my mama and my papa are going to say yes to Jesus. That's my greatest dream. For the first few years, and Brenda and I have been with Maranatha for 7 years now. For the first few years, we spent a lot of time building churches. But when we went to Mozambique the first time, about 5 years ago, we discovered that that was probably not ideal. People wanted schools. We'd go to the union president. We'd go to the division president. Do you want us? Let's say we have $100,000. Do you want schools or do you want churches? Well, it used to be they'd say, churches! They don't say that anymore. Consistently, they say, give us schools. If you build a church, within 2 years, we'll have it full. If you build a school, within 2 years, we will have 8 new churches that need to be built because of the parents of the children going to school. Build us schools, please. And so Maranatha has really been building schools. In fact, this year, we built mainly schools all over the world. Small schools, huge schools, 900 kids schools, 20 kids schools. Whatever the people are asking for, our job is to help make sure they get it. Praise God, sometimes it happens. We're able to answer some of the requests. If we could answer all the school requests today, we would have 80,000 schools under construction. That's a ton of schools. Take 80,000, multiply it by 40 kids, and you know how many children are waiting to be able to go to school in a Seventh-day Adventist classroom. So I've got a Bible story. You ready? Acts chapter 19. And I'm going to read just a couple verses here so you could get the picture. Now it happened that while Apollos was away in Corinth, Paul made his way down through the mountains, came to Ephesus, and happened upon some disciples there. In Paul's life, did he ever happen upon anybody? No. And God led him to some disciples there. And the first thing he said was, I'm so glad to meet some Christians, followers of the way. Did you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? And they said, what's the Holy Spirit? Oh, did God take your mind only, or did he also embrace your hearts? Did he get inside you? We never heard of that. What's this about? Well, then how were you baptized? Well, by the baptism of John. Ah, that's what makes sense now. And so Paul spent a lot of time teaching them about John, teaching them about Jesus. And before they were through, they had the baptism of the Holy Spirit going through that crowd of 12 new converts in Ephesus. So at that point, our friend Paul goes to the synagogue and starts teaching. And for 3 months, he had the run of the place. He talked to everybody about Jesus. He talked about everything Jesus had talked about. He told the stories the way Jesus had told him. He just lived it all. And at the end of 3 months, all of a sudden, there were people who said, get this guy out of here. He's nothing but a crackpot. We don't want him anyway. All he does is talk about Jesus. He ought to be talking about the law. He ought to be. And Paul said, no, it's no problem. I will go do something else. And Paul walked away from the synagogue, walked to the other side of Ephesus, and here's the verse. So Paul left, verse 9, taking the disciples with him and set up shop in the school of Tyrannus, holding classes daily. Now, when I first read that in the context of Maranatha building schools, I said, yeah, we're going to call all of our schools now the schools of Tyrannus. It sounds like a tyranny starting. And I said, why would Paul go to the school of Tyrannus? I mean, and so I do all the digging I'm capable of doing, which isn't very much because I didn't get to take Hebrew or Greek either at Andrews. But I call some friends who did. They said, what's this Tyrannus thing? And they say it has two possible meanings. On one side, it's tyranny. But can you imagine Paul going and teaching in the school of tyranny? It just doesn't sound like Paul. The other side of the possible meanings is prince, son of the king. And so if you're going to the school of Tyrannus, Paul has taken the believers and moved them to the school of Tyrannus, the school of the son of the king, the prince. And what do they do there every day? It's interesting. The schools in Ephesus, because it was so hot, met in the morning. In the afternoon, they didn't go out there. It'd be crazy. It's too hot. That's when Paul took over the school. And so according to the historians, every afternoon, Paul would get people who would want to talk about Jesus. And I like to think that was the first Maranatha school. Jesus came to Ephesus with Paul and just gave people a chance to discuss, to converse. This wasn't a place where there were a lot of sermons. It was a place where there were a lot of discussions. And here's what we learn about it. The rest of the verse, verse 10, he did this for 2 years, giving everyone in the province of Asia, Jews as well as Greeks, ample opportunity for learning the message of the Master. That's what Maranatha does. We build schools, build churches. But what we really do is we listen to people in the world, church leaders, who say, we got to have a school, man. It's really important here. And the reason we need a school is we've got children whose parents will never walk into a Seventh-day Adventist church, but they'll come to the school of Tyrannus. Does that start to make sense? If we go in North Africa, Central Africa, West, East, do you want churches? No, we can't even build churches. It's against the law. But you build the schools. Why? Because if you build the schools, the whole village will come. And they do. Another story. Shepherd boy, age 6. I asked him, Gil, how many animals did you have when you were 6 years old? And he said, well, I was assigned to be with my cousin. And my cousin taught me how to do it. And for 6 months, well, maybe it was 6 weeks, he taught, and maybe it was 6 days, I don't remember. He wasn't there very long. He kind of went away because now it was my job. And so I took over, and I had about 200. I said, you were 6 years old, and you had 200 animals? What were they, all sheep? He said, oh, no, there's always some goats. We had goats, sheep, cows, and one camel. Poor camel. I said, did they have names? Oh, yeah, all 200 of them had names. Did you know their names? And he looked at me, and he crossed his arms, and he said, why, Pastor Dick, of course I knew them all. I was their shepherd. How long did that last? He said, 3 years. For 3 years, I did nothing but take care of sheep, goats, and the camel every morning, every evening. And then one day, my dad came to me. I'm 9 years old. And he said, Gilbert, I'm going to change your life. What are you going to do? I'm going to let you teach so-and-so to be the shepherd now. And I think you need to go to school. You have shown that you can think really well and you can make good decisions, and I think you ought to go to school. So I have done a lot of research, and I have found the very best school in our whole area. We're going to send you there. Now, you need to know, it's a Christian school. It's a Seventh-day Adventist school. I don't want you to get into their religion. The religion's weird, but they teach better morals, better values than anybody else. Far better than the government schools. And so I want you to go and I want you to get top scores. Will you do that? And he said he would. Grades 1 through 6, grades 7 through 8, grades 8 through 12. At the end of 12th grade, when it was time for Gil to graduate, he had not become a Seventh-day Adventist. He had not come forward in a week of prayer. He had refused. He had obeyed his father all the way through this process. But every day, he had been talking and listening and discussing with the teachers, with the pastors, with the other students. What is really valuable here? What are the most important things in my life? What is it that I've got to live for? And I said, so what happened then when you graduate? He said, well, it's really very easy. The day I graduated, my father said, what are you going to do with your life? I told him I wanted to be a Seventh-day Adventist pastor. And my father said, why? Because, Father, the values I have learned and the God I have learned to love quietly is the best thing that's ever happened to me, and I want to teach you and Mom and everybody else in the village about it. All right. Then you must do it well. Gil is now president of the West Central African Division of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's a true story. Now, what makes that story even crazier is that when we went to Gil and said, we've got a little bit of money to spend in Africa. You have come to us and said that you might be interested in Maranatha doing some building. You know what he said? Yeah, I did. What do you need most? Churches? No, don't need any churches. What do you need? I need schools. How many? 200. You need 200? You know, we're just saying 200 schools? Yeah, right. You're just coming up with a number off it. No, he said, no, you'd misunderstood me. In the West Central African Division, there are 22 countries. I need 200 Seventh-day Adventist schools in each of the 22 countries. It's a lot of schools. And we said, where do we start? And the assignment started us in Ghana. We've now built almost all of a 900-student school at Valley View Adventist University in Ghana. We built another school campus close by. We've just finished another 200 school campus clear up in Tamale, way in the northeastern corner. And we're just building, 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 because that's what God has called us to do through Gil, through Gilbert Wadi, who God said, you're a good shepherd. I need you to shepherd my people. Is that just awesome? And so one day, Gil and I were sitting talking in Ghana, and I said, we were on television, Dr. Wari. No, I said, Gil, how do you work as a Seventh-day Adventist administrator, remembering what it's like to be a shepherd with a camel? And he laughed, and he said, I'll tell you what I do. Every morning when I wake up, I listen for God. I open my eyes and I say, okay, Jesus, what do you have for me to do today? And I always keep a piece of paper and a pencil close by my bed. And in the morning, God always gives me two or three things that really have to be done, you know, the really big ones that have to be accomplished. And so I write them down and I just do them. And then I get up and I go about my day. And the first thing I do is I do the three or four things God has given me at my bedside in the morning. And then he quit talking. And I said, Gil, what do you do the rest of the day? And he smiled and he said, I walk along with God and see what he's doing all day. It's his work, isn't it? It's not mine. It's his responsibility. It's not mine. My job is simply to go along with God as his representative. And so I just go along to see what he's doing today. And then together at the end of the day, we celebrate the victories that Christ has accomplished in my work, which is his work. Every time I think about my assignments every day, I think about Gilbert Wadi. When I look at little children, like you talked about, you know, the fat stomach African kids in Sahara, or I'm going to India or Nicaragua or Ecuador or wherever, and I see those kids, I think, I wonder which one of them is Felipe for this country. I wonder which one of them is Gilbert for this country. One more, then I'm done. I met a man in Africa. He's from the Cameroons. And I said, you're a church leader. I am, but it's not important that I'm a church leader. I'm just a guy. So what's the most exciting thing you've ever done? Well, Pastor Dick, one day I was traveling from this town to that town, and we passed a little fork, you know, an intersection in the road, and was on a bus, and God said, get off. So I got off, and God said, go to the yellow house. So I went to the yellow house, knocked on the door. A Muslim man came out and said, who are you? I'm Fred. That's not his name. He said, I'm Fred, and is there anything I can do for you today? Yeah, I have been praying to Muhammad and to Allah that they would send someone to bless us today. I cannot go on without my wife, and she died 2 days ago, and she's still on her cot, on her mat. Would you come in? So Fred went into the hut, the yellow one. Back area is this dead lady. It's not smelling good in here. And he looks at the husband and talks a little bit more about the lady. And the man begins to weep and say, I've just got to have her. I can't live alone. And there's something I need to learn. I know Allah is calling me to do something special. And Fred said, well, then hold my hand. And Fred and the father held their hands and leaned over the woman. As Fred said, God, you brought me off the bus to this town, to this house, to this man, to this woman, for one reason only, I know. And the man has told us the reason is because he needs his wife, because they need to get to know you better. And the lady blinked her eyes, got up, and made them a meal. I said, that's the most exciting thing that's ever happened to you? And I'm thinking of my boring life. And I said, does that ever happen again? Yeah. 6 times, God has stopped me somewhere on my day and told me to go there, to there, to there, to meet so-and-so. And 6 times, I've had the privilege of raising someone to life who has been dead. And I said, and you're a Seventh-day Adventist pastor? Yes. Why don't you put up a big sign that says, I will raise your wife? He said, because too many husbands would be unhappy. No, that's not what he said. Not at all, forgive me. He said, because if I put it up, people would only think of me. And God has not called me to have people look at me. God has called me to listen. Where did you learn that? In a Seventh-day Adventist high school, where a teacher told us the only thing that's really important in life is for us to learn how to listen to the Holy Spirit every day, all day, and then respond. That's what I do. As a pastor, I get up in the morning and I say, where? And then I walk in his footsteps all day long. If I put up a sign, I raise people from the dead, people would only think of me as some odd person. Instead, I put up a sign, I love Jesus. And people love Jesus too, some of them because I had the privilege of holding their hands while Mama came back to life. What does Maranatha do? We do anything we can to let the world know Jesus is here now, eager to bring the armies of heaven so Felipe can lose his rifle forever and we can all go home. Fair enough? The school of Tyrannus. Paul spent 3 years there. And during that time, everybody in Asia, Greeks and Jews, learned about Jesus. School of Tyrannus. Maybe he was talking about Andrews.
When I first started to volunteer for Maranatha, I asked myself, what can I really do? I'm not a nurse, I'm not a doctor, I've never worked in construction, but I felt that I could do something.
You don't need any skill. All you have to do is to have the willingness to be involved in a team and just go with the flow.
They show you how to do it. There are skilled workers here on the Maranatha staff that teach you how to do what you need to do.
Once people are willing, it's incredible what everybody has put in, even from the youngest to the oldest, and I'm somewhere in between.
I wasn't necessarily expecting or planning to be in the kitchen during this mission opportunity, but I have stayed. I love working in the kitchen. It's long hours, but it's fun. You get to talk to each other while you're cutting tomatoes or while you're peeling a million onions or whether you're washing the dishes.
On this particular project, I've learned how to make the windows. It's a bit challenging, but I'm learning step by step, and I learned how to use a drill. I think that's great.
I have seen older than I will be 80 this year. But the thing that really I'm so happy about is to see entire families.
What can mortal men do to me?
And volunteers don't just work. They get opportunities to shop, to explore local history, and to relax and reflect in some stunningly beautiful locations. Are you ready to volunteer?
Let's do this.
If you're the type of person who likes challenges, can be flexible, volunteering on a Maranatha project is for you.
The need is great for service, for volunteering on these projects. And also on a personal level is that I'm becoming more and more flexible.
It will build your faith in God because you see miracles happening all the time. It is just, if you're thinking about volunteering, you should think very seriously because It's worth it. You will enjoy every minute of it.
If you're the person who likes to have new experiences, if you're open to going and doing something worthwhile for somebody who may need our assistance, our ability, I would recommend Maranatha as a fantastic organization to travel with and experience what you can do, or the assistance you can be to others wherever in the world.
Where three are gathered together in your name.
You have to make a start, and by stepping out of that your comfort zone, you'll know what you're capable of doing, how far you're willing to go. So you just have to make that first step.
So who's a Maranatha volunteer? Anybody? Anybody gone? Yeah, there's a lot of you here. Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Peru, Dominican Republic, Zimbabwe. Those are all the places that I've gone to do Maranatha mission trips, and I've had a blast. In that time, I've had the opportunity to be a part of a team that builds three schools. We built four churches. We've done VBSs in all of them, had medical clinics. One trip in Zimbabwe, we tried to do 31-day churches in 10 days. We didn't make it. But we got close. We got close. Our union president, Don Livesay, was there, and his team was putting out 3 1-day churches in 1 day. So it was pretty exciting. Random acts of kindness. Some of you know Dean Yeagley, Steve Yeagley. I'm connected to Maranatha because of him. He invited me on my first trip to Costa Rica, and he introduced me to this idea. You know, every time that we would do a trip, not only would we build buildings, but we'd always do something in the community. And so he said, Jose, I have this perfect idea. It's called the Shoeboy Ministry. I was like, Shoeshine Ministry. And I was like, what is that? So, well, when we get down there, I'll tell you. So we get down there. He's like, okay, Jose, go find all the shoeshine boys in this town. Tell them you're going to pay them for the day so that you can shine shoes in the community. So that's what we did. I took half a dozen to a dozen of my young people that were on the trip. We found all the shoeshine boys in that village, in that town. We paid them for the day and said, okay, teach us how to shine shoes, and we'll go and shine all the shoes for you today. So there's nothing more exciting than to see a bunch of gringos going through town, shining the shoes of the local community people. And they just love it. They just had a good time. But that's what we were doing. We're just building connections. We're building connections with the people there. And those churches and those schools, they fill up. It's an amazing adventure. And Dick's coming up,
and so
he's going to say something.
No, I just got to bother you here. That's cool. One time we were with Steve, and he said, we got to do that same thing. What are we going to do out here in this little village? We were in Chile. And what he ended up doing was teaching us all how to paint the trees white 4 feet up. And so we've got this live, funny paint, and every child, you know, kid that we had with us on this Christmas project was out there painting all the trees. And the people in the community, they just came out and hugged everybody. But the funny thing that happened that trip, there was two people who came along, showed up, and said, we'd like to be volunteers, Andre and Joanna. They weren't married. They were two guys, husband and wife, who'd been wandering through the mountains. And just before we finished the church, Andre and Joanna came to me and Steve and said, are you guys pastors? Yeah.
That's a scary question.
It really was at that point. And so they produced their Chilean marriage certificate or marriage permit, and we performed a wedding, Steve and I together, for Andre and Joanna in the church we had just finished building.
Wow.
Let me add to that.
Same thing happened to me with Steve.
You got married?
No, I didn't get married. I didn't get married.
Now's the time.
No, I didn't get married, but I actually ended up performing a wedding on the last night of the trip. Steve copped out on me, though. He didn't want to do the ceremony. So I was there with my sandals and beach shorts.
We did just something together.
But you know what's really exciting? I don't know if you knew this, but just last year, Steve got married. Steve, why don't you stand up with your beautiful wife And now that you've been on Maranatha.
And you didn't do it on a Maranatha
trip. It wasn't on a Maranatha mission
fair.
Trip, but she would love to be introduced. Let's give Steve a hand for all these amazing marriage stories.
Now, the couple that we married, Andre and Joanna Boric, from Canada, and they have spent the last year in Zimbabwe and Malawi building schools and churches for Maranatha.
Wow, praise God.
It's just amazing, because once you get this whole thing of service in your heart, everything in your life changes.
Amen, amen. So for all of our AU students who are here, go on a mission trip and get married, just make sure you take Dean Yeagley with you. He'll work it out. So honestly, guys, if you're interested, every summer they have Ultimate Workout. They're looking for volunteer staff, collegiate volunteer staff to help with outreach projects, to be team leaders, to help with construction. You work with the teens. It's the most exciting trip. Over at Campus Ministries, we're going to be looking at partnering with Maranatha to do a collegiate trip. They have one every summer, and we're going to work out how we can do that here as part of an Andrews University trip. But here's the last way. If we want you to give you an opportunity to give an offering to Maranatha. They do amazing things, and we're going to do it in a very unique way. It's very simple. So if you want to give an offering tonight, $10 offering, just take out your phone, and you can text this. I'll see it's on the screens there. Text message to 85944 and text the word MVI and then reply yes to confirm a $10 donation. So we want to give you that opportunity to give an offering tonight so that we can continue to build people all around the world, preparing them for Jesus Christ. Let's have a word of prayer. Holy Father, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for everything that you've done in each one of our lives. It's because somebody else has done us the service of telling the gospel to us that we're here tonight. And you are now presenting us with the opportunity to serve others and through our service, share the gospel with them, something that will change their lives forever in the same way that it's changed our lives into eternity. So we pray, Lord, that you inspire us and that you lead us in such a way that we can always be serving you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.